Point of origin, Nairobi. Destination, Eldoret. Mission, flower farming. And no, I'm not going crazy. I am in Marathon County. Let's go!
This is Dr. Nyalala
from Egerton University.
Welcome, Dr.
Yes.
Welcome inside.
Thank you very much. Welcome. Thank you very much.
This farm was funded initially by money from European Investment Bank.
Okay.
In 1997, $1.8 million.
Approximately 164 million Kenyan shillings.
190 million.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the very clear message, you are all borrowed money, that money, if you are going to be able to export a product, mm-hmm. which is flowers you export, mm-hmm. and secondly, if it employs people, mm-hmm. it mm-hmm. must employ people.
Yes.
So we met the two criteria.
How many employees do you have, approximately?
About 600.
600 employees.
Yeah. That's an army.
What made you specifically decide on flower farming?
Flower farming, because I had already seen friends who are doing flowers.
Okay.
And we found already in Europe, mm-hmm. Holland.
Yes.
They are getting out of flowers.
Yes.
And if you notice in Kenya, mm. half of the flower farms are farmers from Europe.
Yes.
And then half of that other half mm. are our compatriots from Indian subcontinent.
Yes.
So a quarter are the indigenous Kenyans. Mm-hmm. And the indigenous Kenyans, they are not that many. It's mm. not easy.
True.
Yes. It requires education mm-hmm. and organizing.
When you want to start flower farming, what are some of the prerequisites of the things that you need to ensure you have or you are around mm. before you begin?
Cultural crops are sold when they are fresh.
Yes.
We call them fresh produce. Mm-hmm. And that simply means they have very high water content. Mm-hmm. Like for roses which are being grown in this farm, mm-hmm. they contain about 75 to 85% mm-hmm. water. Mm-hmm. And in fact, some people do not even call them, you know, products, but they call them water in expensive packages.
Uh-huh.
And for them to have that high water content, mm-hmm. they must also be taking a lot of water.
Yes.
So without water, you cannot talk of flowers, mm-hmm. you cannot talk of horticultural mm-hmm. crops,
okay.
including even vegetables.
Was the river a convenience when you had this piece of land, or you got this piece of land strategically next to a river because of water as a resource?
My own farm did not reach the river.
Uh-huh.
So this was owned by somebody else.
Okay.
I told my mm-hmm. friend, look, mm-hmm. I want us to join into flower farming.
Mm-hmm.
So we bought off this person because we wanted to access the river.
The river.
As the professor said,
yes.
without the river, mm-hmm. okay, we are taking 0.something%
of
the rest goes to Egypt.
Oh, mm-hmm. This goes all the way to Lake Victoria and
the
Nile.
This is the Nile canteen.
This is the Nile canteen.
Yeah. Yes. Uh-huh. So it is going to Egypt.
Mm. Okay.
And they must be watching me as well. Yeah.
You monitor your farm?
Yes.
Using your phone?
Yes.
Or your laptop?
Yes.
Exactly how do you do that?
There are these small cameras now.
Mm-hmm.
Webcam cameras.
Yes. Yes. Mm.
So I can see that fellow. So they know uh-huh. we see them.
You're always watching.
I'm always watching here.
Yes.
Yeah. This is the only private machine in Kenya.
Yes.
That distills. You see that bucket?
Yes.
Yes.
The machine operator is able to throw this bucket inside, mm-hmm. scoop. Mm-hmm. You can see the mountain that he removed the other day.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
It is the only private machine
that is able to do the silting.
The government has two machines. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether they are working, mm-hmm. but this is a private machine.
Mm-hmm.
And really, county government should be hiring this machine to desilt the dams.
Mm. Very necessary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Rivers like this, the soil keeps coming. Even if you have got a dam,
yes.
over time, the silt goes down mm. and then it's built
raises
in
the
it raises
level, the level yeah. of water.
So you've got less and less water.
Yes.
So you need to scoop. And so remove this, because this is the soil here.
Yes.
It's actually removed
yeah.
by the machine.
Mm-hmm. Where specifically do you export to?
Holland is the main market for the auction.
Okay.
But that's not the only one.
Mm.
We also export direct customers in Australia,
okay.
Customers in Japan,
yes.
Customers in Canada,
mm.
Customers in Sweden,
mm.
China,
mm.
yes.
But you also sell locally?
Less than 1%.
Less than what? So your business is mainly for
export.
International
yes,
export.
Yes.
So far, we have seen the dam where the water comes from, where water is the most important resource when it comes to flower farming, any sort of farming at all. How do you plant roses? Do you use seeds? Do you use seedlings?
We have the Zion and the rootstock.
All right. Okay.
So this is the rootstock from
uh-huh.
here.
Uh-huh.
This is the Zion.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And this process is done in our company in Kitengela.
Okay.
The process of grafting.
Okay.
We don't do it here.
Okay.
Yes.
So you bring them here when they've already been grafted?
When they have already been done.
Ah. All right.
Yes.
Okay. So this is where they're connected.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. Okay.
So all roses in this farm have got the same rootstock.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
But it's a different variety, as it either
mm-hmm.
spray or you know
oh.
standard. But this is the same.
This is all the
same.
The
wild rose.
Yes.
Yes.
Where they have covered.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Ah. Yes, yeah, that's the crafting.
Ah, all right, okay. So how long does it take before it it's ready for harvesting? Or what,
from here
the
now
process?
You wait for 6 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Between 4 and 6 weeks you
mm-hmm.
do bending.
Okay. And
bending,
what is bending and what
bending
is it for?
Is for you to get the service area for manufacturing or food for the now exportable stems.
And you can see.
Bending has been done.
Mm-hmm.
These leaves now will be the source of food for exportable stems.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay. So it's not every stem that will have the rose flower that can be exported.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then?
They will eventually come
then from there,
mm-hmm.
you wait for another between, depending on the variety,
mm-hmm.
6 to 8 weeks,
mm-hmm.
you harvest.
Okay.
Continuous.
Okay. For how long?
For depending on the market.
Uh-huh.
If the market changes,
mm-hmm.
you can uproot. If the
mm-hmm.
market continues liking the variety,
mm-hmm.
you continue maintaining it.
For example, the red rose. It's
mm-hmm.
I've seen it ever since I
mm-hmm.
go to see flowers.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
red rose is not a red rose. There are so
there
many.
So
varieties.
Many.
Oh, really?
So he says, these are like women dresses.
Uh-huh.
The flower in there is like women dresses.
Uh-huh.
It changes. The red is different reds.
Uh-huh.
It's not, for you, you see red.
I just see
but
red,
but for
yes.
him,
mm-hmm.
different red.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ah. What system of irrigation are you using?
We have automatic irrigation system.
Uh-huh.
It's called, we have two types. We have NMC and
mm-hmm.
a Priva.
Okay.
Yes, it's automatic.
Uh-huh.
So, for example, sitting with a computer,
mm-hmm.
you see
yes,
the controls
ones.
Are here, sensors.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
But the guy never comes here.
He never
the person
comes.
Irrigating,
uh-huh.
he's sitting in the room, just knows when.
You know, the mm-hmm. greenhouse one, greenhouse
yeah,
two,
yes.
needs this amount.
And we'll explain
so
now.
This is the release of water is through drip?
Through drip lines, yeah.
Through
drip lines.
Yes.
Drip lines.
Yes.
Ah, all right. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably
okay,
yeah,
go.
You can go to the next thing.
This is our trial greenhouse because this business, as the way Mr. Joseph said, it's
mm.
very dynamic.
Yes.
It changes every day.
Yes.
So we need to be going to Naivasha, select the variety, come
mm.
and test,
mm-hmm.
see the production,
mm-hmm.
see disease susceptibility
mm-hmm.
and the market.
Yes.
If you are happy with it,
mm-hmm.
just expand.
Uh-huh.
You grow it.
All right. Okay.
Yes.
So you see,
and
I'm
we have so many colors, different varieties.
Yes, so I can see the
different,
red. The
yeah.
White.
And different reds.
Mm-hmm.
They have
yes.
a name,
mm-hmm.
Love Letter.
Love Letter.
Mm-hmm. Who is the breeder? Olai. So
mm-hmm.
it belongs to them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If you're going to plant,
mm-hmm.
you must pay them for using that.
For their using their breed.
Yes.
Yes.
This one
mm-hmm.
is actually a
steamer.
A steamer.
Mm-hmm.
It boils. It's a boiler.
It's a boiler.
It's a boiler. Boil the water.
We have the water.
Water only.
Steam.
Uh-huh.
Just create steam. He takes that steam into a trailer
uh-huh.
full of this
the media.
Media.
Okay.
To kill any viral, you
mm-hmm.
know.
Which other countries within Africa are
okay.
doing this?
Kenya
mm-hmm.
is the largest exporter of flowers into the Holland.
Yes.
Cut flowers into Holland.
Okay.
But we are competing with South America,
uh-huh.
basically Colombia and Ecuador.
Okay.
Because their altitude is 2,800, 3,000.
Mm-hmm.
They produce big heads.
Mm-hmm.
So Colombia, Ecuador is our big competitor.
Mm-hmm.
Into where? Russia.
Okay.
Because Russia has a lot of big heads.
Yes.
And also into America.
Mm-hmm.
They import into Miami
mm-hmm.
and the whole of USA.
Okay.
In Africa,
mm-hmm.
the biggest competitor is Ethiopia.
Uh-huh.
in running and in growing flowers. Ethiopia is always behind us.
If we look at the figures of flower export to the Dutch auction, Kenya is actually commanding 42% of that market. Ethiopia,
the entire market.
Yeah, number two is Ethiopia, and Ethiopia only has about 23.7. And after that, Israel. Zimbabwe in Africa is also coming up. I think they still have a long way to go. Have some comparative advantages, and I think we'll maintain that for some time. And for the Southern American countries, Colombia somehow is going down. They're mainly concentrating in the US market, which is nearer. Ecuador is still there. It features among the top 10 in the Dutch auction, but it is also going down simply because they have a problem with labor. The labor cost is going high. It's like now South Americans also want to be paid at the same rate as USA. So that means for the future, it may be just the African countries that will be the main players.
And actually, Professor, our biggest potential is the US market.
Yes.
The day we're able to fly from Nairobi to the US direct.
Exactly. Yes.
So when Obama comes, it will be one of the top agenda items.
Sure. Okay.
Yes.
Drive okay.
To get planes going from Kenya
straight to the US.
US.
Yeah.
The US people love our flowers.
Yes.
But at the moment they go to Holland
by the time
it's too getting, long.
Yes.
Yeah. And as he says, because it's water, it's the quality is not that good.
Another thing that you mentioned, Mr. Chesterim, is about the need to up our standards as far as not just flower farming, but farming itself, creating wealth for us, as ourselves as Kenyans, also for food security in our country, because most young people are really not into farming.
It's a paradox because we most Kenyans go to bed without eating, not because they have chosen not to eat. There's no food.
Yes.
And yet we've got land, we've got water, we've got labor. It's a paradox. Because we have not invested enough money to harvest the rainwater.
Yes.
So we must harvest rainwater. Secondly, we must bring cheaper electricity so that people can irrigate. And then we must go for drip irrigation.
Yes.
Not this open flower.
Yes, yes.
So that's what we must do. But I am certain county governments will do it. Money and work will be found in production of food.
Yes.
The world's population is moving towards 9 billion. And they must eat.
So many people.
And the only producer of food is Africa.
Yes.
So young people must learn
about
farming. But we've given farming a very bad stigma.
Yeah.
When I left Central Bank, people said, what are you doing these days? I'm saying I'm a farmer. They said, could the government not give you a better job? I said, no. Actually, I went there a bit. I should have been back to farming quickly. The government has to create those infrastructure. Water, cheaper electricity,
yes,
and then extension service. Extension service is very important.
If as a country we are to reap the full benefits of agribusiness, it will require all hands on deck, from the government to international stakeholders, and most importantly, the youth. More to come after the break.
These are actually the cartons. They make the cartons out of this. And this is what goes, the flowers go into these cartons.
Yes.
Never to be returned.
The boxes never
they
come
go out. One way. It's very expensive. These are different types of fertilizers because Namia will explain to you. They have to go and mix fertilizer because you've got to feed this thing.
Yes.
Remember I told you they're using hydroponics?
Yes.
So there's nothing, they rely only on the food from
The drip line from the water.
Yeah, but this is soluble fertilizer.
So the fertilizer is put in the water?
In the water, mixed, filtered,
yes,
and then sent to the greenhouse. We've got a lot of certifications. Audits are done. They will come, from the auction to talk to staff alone. Mm. To even talk to our neighbors. Mm. Yeah. Mm. So how is this company?
Yeah. How are they relating with
to the neighborhood?
Yes.
The staff are you being treated?
Mm-hmm. You should not produce something beautiful, but you are very ugly to the people around you.
You can be ugly to the people around you, ugly to the environment, mm-hmm. and that's not good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the most very, very important is how you treat the staff.
Yes.
They must have that ownership, because this is a manual. This is a manual.
Yes.
You remember? It's a manual.
Yeah.
They come very early in the morning.
Yeah.
You see that bull there?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see the bull?
Yes.
That was announcing party last year to eat. Every end of the year is a party.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hey, you are very good to your employees. That is very nice.
They own this company.
That's very honorable.
Own the company.
Flower farming is a very competitive business. To stay ahead of the game, you must look after your workers.
Okay, probably I can ask, how can one get into flower farming?
Yes. The way you get the flower farm, mm-hmm. and the person will confirm, mm-hmm. is like a child mm-hmm. beginning to walk.
Uh-huh.
No one gets into flower farming on day one. Remember, I started with cabbages,
mm-hmm.
then with Nemia, he started doing cotton peas, mm-hmm. snow peas.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to passion fruit, mm-hmm. because in 1995, I was saying I want to do flowers
mm-hmm.
in 95.
Mm-hmm.
I brought friends of mine, mm-hmm. they are from central Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
They saw my farm up there.
Mm-hmm.
They told me, I've got a farm,
mm-hmm.
you've got water,
mm-hmm.
one thing is missing. I asked them, what?
Mm-hmm.
They think you have no labor.
Can flower be grown on small scale?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the answer is yes,
mm-hmm.
but you have to start with summer flowers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, summer flowers are those flowers which are grown outdoor.
Okay.
We call them summer flowers because in Europe or in temperate region, they are normally grown during summer.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got no summer here.
Yeah. So for us here, we have no summer.
Yes.
So just because they are grown outdoors
mm-hmm.
and they are a little bit easier,
mm-hmm.
people call them summer flowers.
Mm-hmm.
And it is true, we have quite a number of farmers in Kenya who have adopted that.
Mm-hmm.
They start small by growing easy flowers. For example, there's one called Arabica.
Mm-hmm.
We have a tuberose.
Mm-hmm.
We have Eryngium.
Mm-hmm.
So that is actually the starting point. Mm-hmm. Like he puts it, it's very difficult for you to wake up today and have a rose farm.
Actually, that's one thing I deduced myself. Just by going around your farm and seeing the details of the things that need to be done, it's not something you just
miss. Even the employees, it's a big industry.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
As small-scale growers or summer flower growers,
mm-hmm.
in most cases, they may not even be able to penetrate market on their own. They have to go through maybe the big guys
mm-hmm.
or the big farms or people already in the industry.
And normally we buy from them.
Exactly.
We buy to make bouquet.
Yes.
To mix.
Ah.
So that when Namia is selling,
mm-hmm.
they would have bought from the summer flowers
mm-hmm.
from the small grower.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have here, but in central province, they do a lot of this. And that's where we want to encourage the farmers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So does a farmer need any technical know-how to get into flower farming?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually where floriculture differs from other horticultural crops.
Yeah.
These others, like vegetables, fruits, you can just wake up, maybe walk to a nursery, or you go to a shop, buy your seeds, and make a nursery and plant, but not flowers. Most of these operations, or the cultural practices, they are very precise. There's no guessing about it. So you have to do it exactly the way it is for you to get the results. And the quality is paramount.
Yes.
And that is another reason why the Kenyan flowers are doing well internationally.
Because of the quality.
Quality.
On national level, floriculture is actually part of horticulture.
Yes.
And apparently, almost every upcoming university is having a horticulture program.
Okay.
And what is driving this a lot is the flower industry.
Mm-hmm.
So much that even people are doing other courses,
mm-hmm.
they want to do cut flower production so that one day they will also get a job in a flower farm. Mm-hmm.
It can be daunting for someone who wants to get into floriculture, but there are a number of bodies that work with flower farmers across the value chain. If you are a farmer who is starting out, you can talk to existing farmers, Horticultural Crops Directorate, or other organizations like the Kenya Flower Council, Kenya Agriculture and Livestock Research, Horticultural Crops Research Institute, and if exporting, the Kenya Plant Health Inspectorate Service, KEFIS, can be your best bet.
When he sends his flowers to the airport, KEFIS people have to inspect these flowers before they go out.
If they find one insect,
the whole bunch is sent back.
It is something very serious.
Yeah.
KEFIS,
yes.
Our fruits, horticulture, if they find one insect, serious.
Yeah. But it is better for KEFIS to find that insect here.
If it's found in Holland.
Than the insect being found abroad.
The whole country's name is in trouble.
Are there areas within the country where you can do flower farming? Are there areas where you cannot do flower farming?
Yes, yes, yes. That is key. Altitudes of 1,500 and above. 1,500 meters, you are doing well. Up to 2,400. If it goes a little high, it's too cold.
The altitude plays a major role, particularly for roses. Simply because I think you must have heard this saying that the higher you go, the cooler it becomes.
Yes.
And for these roses, the cooler it is, the slower will be the growth rate. And when a plant is growing slowly, it will tend to accumulate a lot of dry matter. So you end up with a heavy stem and also very tall.
Yeah.
Fortunately, the market likes that.
Why is the length a dictator of the price?
The longer the stem,
yes,
the more happier these wazungus are.
Yes.
Small flowers is really the cheap end. So the people buy long flowers. It is true. Ukampani cannot grow flowers, so it's no point for Mr. Mbiti to say I've got water or to place a river, I want to grow roses.
So thank you very much, Mr. Chesserem, for inviting us to your farm and actually taking time to be here with us and taking us around yourself.
We are the ones to thank you because you are town people that we have taken the trouble to visit us in the rural Kenya. We are most grateful you have come.
It's very ironic that he is the one talking about rural Kenya. And thank you very much,
Professor
Daktari, for also being with us here.
Thank you so
and
much.
Also giving us information on very many scientific terms that we would not have otherwise known. And thank you very much. But when a general manager.
Yes,
the thank general
you.
Manager.
Again, yes.
Also,
yes.
And we would want to come again and
welcome
see
again.
More of what you're doing.
Okay, you're welcome.
I can guarantee only one thing. I will not be taking you around. You are too slow for us.
First, we need to put a disclaimer that it is not that we are slow. It's only that he's from Rift Valley and he's very fast. There is a difference. So that was our day at Ikota Flower Farms with Mr. Chesserem and the lecturer from Egerton University and the general manager. We have seen how flower farming happens in his farm. So much goes into it. For sure, you cannot just wake up one morning and decide, oh, I want to do flower farming. There's a lot of preparation that goes into it, a lot of resources that you would need, but you can always start at any point. They have advice that you can start with summer flowers, that you can grow into the big franchise that Mr. Chesserem has today. That's how to make super money on Seeds of Gold.
The longer the rose stem, the more it fetches in the flower auctions abroad. It is a business that is as profitable as it is costly to run. Still more to come after the break. Floriculture is one of the most highly regulated industries worldwide. I decided to catch up with Jane Gigley, the CEO of the Kenya Flower Council, a body whose mandate is to represent the interest of the Kenya flower growers and exporters. They ensure there is adherence to required industry standards by farmers and that the government policies are friendly to the stakeholders.
One of the things that we had to do in 2006 was to open up the membership of the Kenya Flower Council to the small scale growers, which they can join in as individuals or as collectives, you know, farmer groups and all. And right now as we speak, the products that are mainly grown by small scale growers, which are outdoor crops or what is called summer flowers, the non-rose products or the fillers that go into flowers, are now gaining quite a bit of market share. I couldn't say for certain, but we think around about 10-15% of the flowers that are exported out of this country come from this segment. So it's been a growing segment in the flower industry. And we can see this because of the number of small-scale growers we see who are actively growing, who are actively wanting to find out what Kenya Flower Council is all about and wanting to join into the membership and participating in the activities of the Kenya Flower Council. Over the years, the industry has become quite resilient to a lot of the challenges that it faces. And I can also say that this is one economic activity which has demonstrated the fact that it is here to stay.
After running around Mr. Chesserem's farm, a couple of things have come out clearly. Number one, flower farming is not for the faint-hearted. A lot of time, patience, and technical know-how needs to go into it. But you can still start from somewhere with the summer flowers. So, to all the ladies out there, understand this. By the time he gives you that stem of a flower, that flower has gone through a lot. So please, cherish it. That's a tip from me and the Seeds of Gold.
Of opportunities across the floriculture value chain. Anne Modoni, for instance, is a trained florist, and in her own words, this business has been very good to her.
Hello.
Hello.
Modoni.
Yes.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Salama kabisa.
Yeah.
Hapa ndipo kwako.
Ndio.
Hapa ndio unafanya kazi ya maua.
Yes.
Yeah, so what exactly wewe ufanya nini aswa na maua?
Mimi nafanya arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
That's floral arrangement.
Okay.
Kwa occasion zozote,
mm-hmm.
Birthday,
mm-hmm.
A funeral,
mm-hmm.
Corporates,
okay.
And any other occasion.
Uliingia kwa hii biashara ya maua, kivipi na ulianza, lini ulianza wapi? What's your story?
My story nilianzia Westlands.
Mm-hmm.
By then tulikuwa tunauzia kwa barabara.
Okay. Ah.
Karudi nikaenda shule.
Okay.
Kuna shule za floral arrangement. Mm-hmm. So nikaitwa Intercon. Mm-hmm. Intercon nikaenda.
Mm-hmm.
Na nikaambiwa after 3 months hivi nikaplaiwa.
Mm-hmm.
Bado housekeeping.
Okay.
Nikafanya.
Mm-hmm.
Na tukiwa Intercon, mm-hmm. Intercon walikuwa wamepewa kazi State House.
Mm-hmm.
So in every week, mm-hmm. tulikuwa tunaenda thrice at State House kufanya
one
kazi.
Week. Three times.
One state week, house. Yes.
Yani, unaingia tu State House kama vanyo unaingia kwa your favorite hotel.
Hata ilikuwa kama nyumbani. After 5 years, mm-hmm. nikaenda, nikaitwa kibarua.
Mm-hmm.
Hata niliitwa tu na mtu alikuwa na event, akaniambia ni yalentie tu centerpiece.
Mm-hmm.
Now like this.
Okay.
Zilikuwa 40,
mm-hmm.
na zikuwa zinaenda Serena Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
So nika arrange.
Mm-hmm.
Na nikampelekea.
Mm.
Me, my first time kupata pesa zangu, 60K.
Mm-hmm.
Within no time, one day.
Na siyo mshahara.
Na siyo mshahara.
Umeangojea mwisho wa mwezi.
Na bado niko kazi. Hiyo ikanifurahisha sana.
Uh-huh.
So, nikatoka.
Mm-hmm.
Vile nilianza kujua vile nitatoka huko nilizei.
Mm-hmm.
Na kutafuta kazi, nikatafuta client kwanza. Mm-hmm. Wenye nitakuwa nikitengenezea, nikiwa free.
Ah, of course, wezi tu wacha kazi na ujui unaenda kufanyia nani.
Sasa nikapata client watatu.
Mm-hmm.
So, nikatafuta njia kuresign ukule juu ilikuwa sasa mara mingi na hepa,
mm-hmm.
na excuses.
Mm-hmm.
So, nika resign.
Mm-hmm.
Vile ni resign.
Mm-hmm.
Kazi ikawa mzuri sana. The first year and the second year, it was very good. For that time, sasa nikaona, wow, this industry has money.
So, wewe, I can guess, mm-hmm. hauna shamba mahali ambapo unapanda hizi maua.
Hapana. Mimi sina shamba na sichukui maua kwa shamba.
Ehe. Unatoa maua zako wapi?
Maua zangu kuna suppliers.
Okay.
Kuna suppliers wanaenda farm, mm-hmm. wanaleta maua, mm-hmm. city market.
Okay.
Na kuna wengine tuko nao tu hapa. Mm-hmm. Ninanunua tu hapa.
Mm-hmm.
Nawaambia niletee hii, niletee hii, hata nitaletewa mpaka hapa.
Okay. How has this business changed your life?
For one, mm-hmm. can say exposure.
Imeku expose
kabisa. Uh-huh. Kwanza exposure ndio imeni expose sana.
Inakusaidia unafunguka macho.
Unafunguka, unaona how other people survive.
Yeah.
Na imetuma nijue mambo mingi sana.
Mm-hmm. Okay, of course, it goes without saying finances.
Finances, I can't say ati haiko iko mbaya.
Okay, sasa tuingie sabu. Hapa tuko seeds of gold. Tunataka kuona gold sasa.
Mm-hmm.
So, ndio utengeneze kama hii moja.
Uh-huh.
Hii ambayo umetengeneza na dakika tatu, ambayo uh-huh. bado siamini.
Uh-huh.
How much will you sell it for?
1,200 mm-hmm. to 600.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Hapo katikati.
Hapo katikati.
Somewhere in between, yes. Alafu, inaweza kuimia kukost kama how much? Can you quantify per unit?
Kamu per unit, I can say. At cost, inakuja 400, 450.
Mm-hmm. So, kwa mwezi, unaweza kuwa umetengeneza hizi zote ngapi?
Maybe 1,000.
1,000.
Yeah.
So, 1,000 of this.
Yeah.
So, quick math, hapa tuko seeds of gold, the sabu ni lazima tufanye haya. Uh-huh. So, 1,000 units.
In the least.
And each you're selling at approximately, let's say, 800. Tukikata hapo katikati ya 600 na 1,200, that is 900 actually.
Yeah.
So, 1,900. Mm. And then you have a cost of 500 for example. Mm. So to do your difference, 500 minus 900, I mean 900 minus 500, that is 400. 400 you your profit per kiake kwa moja. So 400 times 1,000 of this mm-hmm. in a month.
Yeah.
So that is 400 times 1,000. 400,000 yoni profit per kiake. Akwapi mtu ni muzie yangu ya kwanza nianzie my way towards 400,000. Just before we wrap up this week's episode, I'd like to introduce to you to Mifugo ni Mali, a segment brought to you by KCB Foundation. This segment will be coming to you twice in a month, and we will be dealing with the livestock value chain. Today finds us in Eldama Ravine, where our business is animal nutrition and feed ratios. Let's meet the farmer.
This farm is called Poly Farm. I started way back in 1990. I think it's around 25 years old now. When I started, I had only one cow. I didn't have a dairy, so we were just milking it in the field. That is way back in 1990. So after milking, we used to allow the cow to roam around in the farm. By the end of the day, it comes back and we milk. Due to the size of the farm and the information that we were given by the people of the Ministry of Agriculture, then we had to embrace the new technology on how to farm. So as my cows increased, then I had to build a small dairy unit where we were doing what we call semi-zero grazing. So there we used to feed the animals in the morning, and then we allow them to move out. But because of the trainings that we got from the Ministry of Agriculture, we found it was not working very well because we were not getting enough milk. a lot of the grass in the farm were being destroyed by the cows trampling on them. So after further consultation from the Minister of Agriculture, then we were able to change the whole dairy unit, and we were able to confine the animals in the farm, where we were feeding them there, we were giving them water and everything. And we found the milk was progressively increasing until now that we have this herd, which you can see here. We think we are now feeding them properly, because the feeds we have, we ration them properly, and we're able to give the animal a balanced food. When we talk of nutrition, we are trying to see what the cow requires. So from what we have learned from the experts, we are told we must give a certain amount of proteins, a certain amount of vitamins, and other types of requirements that the cow requires. So with the kind of rationing we've been told to be doing, then we are able to improve the health of the cow. We are also improving the production of the cow. And we are doing it much better than it used to be before. In the 90s, 2000s, I used to have a lot of problems in paying school fees. But with these cows, we were getting enough milk which could support the cow and us. We were also able to sell the heifers, and we were getting some good money from the heifers. And I was able to educate my children without calling for harambe.
For most farmers, they just know the cow can be left to look for food on its own. They have not really gone into dairy as a business. But with the current reducing land sizes, we are emphasizing the farmers or encouraging them to go into intensive systems. Nutrition and ration really matter in dairy production because it contributes to 80% of the total cost of production. And if proper feeding is done, that is, the cow is given feed rich in energy-giving, protein, vitamins and mineral salts, it means milk production will go up, the animal will be in good condition, and the farmer will earn good money.
KCB is a partner to us farmers through the ministry. Now, what KCB did was, it was able to fund societies. They were able to give them money so that they can stock their stores. So currently, when we are looking for dairy meals, when we are looking for salt, we simply go to our cooperative society and we get them at affordable prices. And I think they have done a wonderful job.
Well, you all heard it for yourselves. Key to maximum production in your animals is proper nutrition in the right ratios. Let's keep the conversation going. Follow us on Twitter at Seeds of Gold TV. Follow us on Facebook. Like us on Facebook at Seeds of Gold TV. This is Seeds of Gold. Let's get healthy.